amazing place and you've got an amazing story. And so I wanted to see if we could spend a little time today talking about the customers and the eaters that, and what are the type of people that would benefit from having the types of services you provide and then how they benefit. So maybe if we could start out by, you know, what is your you define it as an eater in some of your podcasts. So kind of share with that, what does that mean and what are those people, who are those people and why do they like to, what are they interested in?
Okay. Well, first of all, Monty, thank you, and welcome to my future. So, okay, I don't know what all they're interested in.
Okay.
I am learning from you the way that you're thinking about trying to seek people out, but what I did was define what I'm looking for and who I'm looking for to partner with. And then I just leave it up to everyone to decide if they're interested in fitting the bill.
And kind of how do you let them decide what information do you give them or?
Well,
what does it look like?
Yeah, I guess it's not as succinct and concise as what you're doing, and so I appreciate this opportunity because maybe this video will help them. So that'll be cool. I only want to work with eaters because I know that currently we are operating in a society that has been trained by the corporatocracy to basically operate in a dehumanized, immoral fashion. And I don't think people realize that. I know that the word immoral is pretty strong. And, you know, a lot of people will probably be offended by that, but they don't understand what morality is. Because there's this confusion, there's a lot of chaos around language, and there's linguistic theft happening these days where there are people who have knowledge of universal and natural laws, and they haven't shared all of that information with everyone. And when there's a knowledge differential, there's a power differential. And so, you know, our centralized institutions no longer behave as human, and they don't have any personal responsibility, and therefore they operate immorally and irresponsibly and forcibly. And they're pushing people into behaving in what folks these days are calling political correctness, which actually what political correctness is that we're supposed to support and promote and accept lies. And that is 100% immoral. So I talk about morality here on the board. Morality lines up with truth. And immorality aligns with lies. And if you don't want to know the difference between that, or if you want to walk the line because you don't want to have hard conversations, because you don't want to rock the boat, or you just don't want to care enough, because that's also a natural law principle, is care.
Yes.
Care is the eighth and generative principle of the natural laws. It is the hidden principle that most people don't know. Because from, you know, when you're a toddler, you are trained in the institutional educational system not to care. You know, when a child tries to go hug on and love on somebody, they're told to keep their hands to themselves. They're told to mind their own business. They're told to take care of themselves and not other people. And when you raise children in that way, and you push them through that for 12 solid years, they don't care about other people. They're trained to only care about themselves because they get in trouble when they try to care about other people. And they're told that they can't control other people anyway, which is true because we all have free will, but we are of love. And it is our natural instinct to operate in that care. But they train it out of everyone.
So you're using food and distribution of food and growing of food as a way for people to share that love?
No, well, I wasn't trying to do this, okay? what I'm doing is I wrote a book about it, but I started in this because we had a child that was medically murdered. And I mean, that's the long and the short of it. It's all in context in my book because it's too much to talk about right now. But the big deal is that the corporatocracy that operates as a machine and not as a human being, that machine has industrialized our food, which essentially creates poison. That's what they create. It's not actually nourishment. And because it's toxic, because it's poisonous, then we, as a side effect, have a society that is suffering with constant dis-ease. And that dis-ease, you know, people are just looking for relief. That's what they're looking for. And in our case, our daughter was murdered. We figured out that, you know, we were complicit, and we had to take responsibility for the fact that we contributed towards participating in cheap and easy food. And it's not really food. I mean, I 100% say, you know, it is poison. Anything that is meets health code is poison. So if it is USDA approved or NCDA approved or FDA approved, I won't eat it. I won't allow my children to have it. And it is 100% poison. And because the institutions no longer operate as human. They have no personal human responsibility. They don't have to care. And so who's in charge? Nobody. So if nobody's in charge, that means anybody can do anything. Oh no, they have to follow the regulatory system, which is created by people who don't care. And if they do care, the institution doesn't care.
Because it's such a big organization, it's easy to get lost, I guess.
Well, what looks really good on paper, or what seems like it's the way to go, is to disinfect and denature everything to the degree where it is dead and lifeless. And if it is dead and lifeless, it's easier to manage, it stores well, it, you know, goes a lot further. And so it's logical to a computer or, you know, any institution that is viewing something for efficiency only and not for care, life-giving force, human nature, and truth. Because the truth is aligned with nature.
Right.
Science is aligned with questions. The truth is knowing. It's knowledge. It's not wondering. It's not confused. There's no chaos. There's nothing going on that is a question. There's no question. There's only answers.
So it sounds like you've got a customer base, a base of eaters.
I should define eaters. So there's a vocabulary that's been trained into sales, which is consumerism. So consumers are ignorant, meaning like they don't actually know anything. They're leaving it up to professionals, or they've been trained to trust the science, which means other human beings' opinions. That's what it means. It doesn't mean walking in the truth. So that is a dehumanized variety of what is a misunderstood truth. Like, people think science is truth. It's not. Science is a man's opinion. And generally, it is convoluted and wrong. Nature is, science also is the study of nature, which people have forgotten. And or it has been written out of history, because history is being rewritten on the minute, you know, by the institutions that are dehumanized, that are no longer operating as human. Maybe not necessarily on purpose, or maybe, I don't know. I don't know that answer, but what I know for sure, is that nature is solid, and it is honest, and it is the truth, And it is evidenced continuously, like this. That's gravity. It works every single time.
It's amazing.
Every single time. It never doesn't work. Every single time, it just does the same immediately. It's immediate. And it has, there's a consequence like that for behavior. That is morality. So morality is not objective. There is an immediate consequence that the laws of nature, the universal laws, that is happening. Whether you believe, your belief isn't required in that, you know, like, it's just
so. It sounds like the members of the organization, this really resonates with, that's what I would suppose. And so they're searching for, when they
relief.
Come here.
Relief.
And so they found a place where they can find relief. And part of that relief comes from
truth.
And part of that truth then leads to a more healthy diet.
I'm not going to say that. I want to say something. Anybody who comes here to get their food also is free to eat wherever they eat, which is not necessarily everything from here. I think that there's an illusion or a disillusion in people who think that, oh, if people are getting food from the food church, they must be so healthy. Not really, because everybody doesn't come here and only get food from here.
Sure.
Some of them do. Some of them really do, because they're very militant about it, because they know. They know why they're here. There's a whole other group of people who are, you know, they like to operate in what's called an 80-20 rule or something, or 50-50 or something like that, or even 90-10, and this is just 10%.
Sure.
Because they don't believe themselves that they are deserving. They don't believe that they are worthy. They don't believe, you know, like, It's a conflict for them financially. Normally, it's always about money, which means that they don't believe that they're worthy. They don't understand that, maybe. You know, I try to help them see that they are worthy beyond belief, that, you know, they don't have anything to prove to anybody. Like, they were just born worthy. But, you know, they have to believe that. I can just see that over them. I can just love over them. I can pour love over them. A lot of people can't even receive it when they don't love themselves.
True. That's very true. See that getting away.
Yeah, I think that's probably a bigger obstacle than anything.
So when people come, they're looking for
relief.
And so part of that relief is through understanding and opening their eyes to what's going on in the world around them, rather than subcontracting it out to somebody else to tell them, I guess.
Well, maybe. Some of them are subcontracting it out to me and relying on me to vet all the food out or whatever. Or they need someone, they believe, to do some of the work for them. Which, listen, some of them know what they want, but they don't have time to do the other things because they do have fiscal responsibility that they have to manage. And so they're like, hey, I know I'm trusting you and, you know, I could do this myself, but I'm going to let you do this since you love it and I'm doing this. And, you know, there's a lot of give and take because I have a partnership with a lot of members where they're helping. I mean, I'm learning things from them and, you know, this isn't a grocery store. We have a personal relationship. There's a trust that's mutual.
So it's more of a community.
It is 100%. Well, it's human.
Right.
It's a human relationship, hence the eater term. Because eating is an agrarian act.
Yes.
And, you know, consuming it's a bot. Like, that's what robots do.
Okay. So, the people that are part of the organization, so in what ways do they kind of develop healthier habits and lifestyles? You know, so they may change their eating habits and eat food that's healthier because of how it's grown.
They have access to cleaner food. And, you know, I've been accused of making claims by the institutions. And to which I have to say, I am not making any claims. I am speaking the truth. And that is all.
Okay. So I think what I'm hearing is they're coming and they're becoming part of an organization where they're showing love and they're seeing other people that care for them. And then maybe that changes some eating habits, but also you're connecting some of the local farmers who have higher quality practices. So they're, I guess...
Well, they're operating in the truth.
Yes. Okay. So the farmers that provide products for this, what's the difference between that and grocery store products?
Health code and institutional interference.
Okay. So the farmers, what do they do differently than the big scale farms do?
Everything.
Okay.
They don't operate institutionally. They don't operate immorally. And that is because they are radically self-reliantly responsible. They're taking responsibility. Commodity farmers are also radically self-reliant. I mean, they're pretty, powerful folk, I'm not trying to take anything away from any commodity producers in that regard, but they are manipulated and they are complying with institutions that are operating in lies and immorality. So they're 100% operating in lies. And they may be doing it because they don't feel like there's any other option. Probably because they feel, because eaters have evidence to them that they're not eaters, they're consumers. They prefer to be consumers because they have been diminished to the point that they don't love themselves. And I'm trying to pour love back into people so they can walk back in their full power. Because if they can't walk back in their full power, they can't love themselves enough to care.
So I take it that people are receptive to that?
Well, no, not always. You would imagine, a lot of people just think I'm a mean, nasty person because I'm loving them. But what I've learned, and I don't know, you might have you ever experienced when you're in a group with some people, and maybe there's that one old man that's just, praying over people all the time, and like maybe he comes up to somebody and he starts talking them to death about something that's so good and so, powerful, that person can't take it. And they're just like, God, this man won't stop talking, like, save me, like, help. They're trying to get out of the conversation all the time, when all that man's doing is pouring love over them.
Yes, and maybe some wisdom.
But they can't receive it.
So why not?
Well, I think that if you have been trained to believe that you're unworthy, then you only know how to operate in diminishment.
Gotcha. So it's part of that same systemic...
It's a plague.
Yeah.
I call it a plague. I think that, in my observation... So I don't... It's not my opinion. It's my observation. It's a real experience that I have in observing people that they just... don't believe that they're to be loved that way. And if I try to love on them, they just repel it, and it's like, what are you doing? They just immediately fall into, they've been, it's actually a trigger for a lot of people. And trigger is a professional psychological term for somebody who is under mind control. That when you try to love them, they're triggered into believing or having some, they operate in this reactionary lifestyle where they are like, you're out to get me. And they only operate in fear and chaos and confusion. And truth operates in knowledge, in knowing. Look, I was that same diminished somebody who was talked into allowing the medical mafia to make medical decisions for our child, and now she's dead. And I have to take responsibility for that. And I do. And I because I take responsibility for that, I feel like it is my moral obligation to inform and educate and love other people enough to let them know, hey brother, hey sister, you being manipulated. And you don't have to be. Because we have free will, right?
Absolutely. So can you share some different examples, not names, of course, or anything, but some specific examples of here's things where people came in, they changed the lifestyle, they changed a viewpoint, they learned, and how that impacted them?
Sure, I got stories. First of all, if you read my book, the back of the book, the last third of the book is just people's testimony, where they're sharing that themselves. But a lot of people are shy and also, you know, may not want their names to be published. So I can share some of those stories that you wouldn't read in the book. For example, I have a person in the membership who, when she arrived, the first time I ever met her, she was in a wheelchair, diagnosed with MS, really couldn't talk clearly. She had lost a lot of her verbal ability, and you could just see tears in her eyes when she would talk to me. Like, you could tell she's trying to talk to me about something and she can't actually articulate her, you know, what she wants to say.
That's rough.
And I was like, you know, I remember my kids were very small. Children are just extra honest, you know, and they were just like, Mom, I think that person is kind of, you know, like something's wrong. And I go, yeah, they're not well. Like, they need help, you know, we have to help them. And so I remember, you know, encouraging her to, you know, really invest heavily in red meat and in the meats. And I was trying to encourage her to not eat so much sugar, you know, oils, carbs, things like that. And it was really difficult for her, or anybody really, to let go of anything in a bag or a box. And everything in a bag or a box is, you know, made with oils, like actual machine oil, not even edible. But it was incredible to watch her, because she was so desperate for relief. So I told her, I said, I'm asking you for a 6-month commitment to only eat things that you buy from here. Even if you eat the cornmeal to make the cornbread, whatever, because, you know, like, I just wanted her to not eat out of the store and to control all the components of what she was eating. And she had expressed that she has trouble cooking. We used to have a gluten-free baker for the membership for a decade. And at that time, we had her. And so we also had farm moms that were preparing soups and stews and things of that nature. And so I offered her these prepared meal options. And I said, why don't you start with this? And then, you know, because if you're unwell, start with this and then see where you're at. 7 days, 12 days, you know, whatever. You know, give it a month, give it 3 months, you know. I said, but I'm asking for 6 months commitment. And I said, I'm not going to penalize you, but I'm just trying to get your mind ready for it. Do you know, in 7 days, she could talk?
It was a nutritional thing.
It was 100% malnourishment. 100%.
That's scary.
In 7 days, she was able to speak clearly. Within 30 days, she was out of a wheelchair. And now she comes in here and you wouldn't know who she is.
Wow.
I mean, now, of course, it's been, what is it? She joined in 2012. So whatever, it's 2023. Yeah. You won't know who she is. We'll have any idea.
That's amazing. That is amazing.
She's completely asymptomatic.
Wow. So kind of, what is this? Think about
asymptomatic, by the way, means that you have no symptoms,
right?
Which means you're healed. I just want to make that clear for the people who don't know.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no symptoms then.
Well, because they redefined asymptomatic, so I just want everybody to know it means no symptoms.
It might be something underlying, but if it's suppressed, it doesn't matter.
Right.
So what is kind of, if you think about the spectrum of your members, what do they, what kind of, maybe some different personas in there? What is the different, does it vary from person A to B? Kind of, if you could walk through that, what are those, and maybe as you're going through, maybe what are those people, what are they looking for? What are they finding?
Everybody's looking for relief.
Okay.
Everybody's looking for a relief of some sort. What is the relief? that's different for everybody because they don't know what they don't know, right? And everybody's journey is different. Everybody's life experience is different. We have people who come in here who are like, I just want to know that I'm supporting somebody local.
Okay.
They don't have a clue about what's happening with the food system. They don't believe that they have any illness or anything that they're suffering from because they're asymptomatic,
right.
You know, maybe. Or maybe they have symptoms, but they don't recognize them as symptoms of something or whatever. So we have everybody who knows nothing about that. They just want to support somebody local,
mm-hmm.
to someone who has cancer and they're managing their cancer, their MS, their children's autism, their child who's constantly seizing, we're able to stop seizures, you know, like on the spot. So we have these very, very serious families who are like, have learned that nature has grace, have learned that by being here, that truth and morality and nature, when you align with that, because, you know, morality is when your thoughts and your emotions and your actions align. That's what morality is. And those people are very militant. They won't allow you to speak lies around them, like I won't either. I have this big sign up here that says, nothing but the truth. Nothing but the truth. Because if you come in here and you're saying something and I know it's a bold lie, I'm gonna tell you. I feel like it's my moral obligation to say, no brother, no sister, that's not right. Like, you know, this is actually what's true.
So it sounds like some of the people are looking for, some people, like you said, looking for a local foods, farm to fork experience. Some people are looking for to healing through nutrition, and maybe some people are the food is a smaller part, and they're looking for community because they're frustrated with some part of their lives or not fitting in or
yeah. I think that everybody here doesn't really feel like they fit in. I think that we want to make it be more of a community that they can immerse themselves in more. I'm looking for land actually for that, you know, to be able to do that there, but it's difficult to kind of do that in town, you know, and also the people who need it are in town. So are they going to participate on a regular basis if they have to go out to a farm? No, they're not. You know, that's the reason why it's so important that I've been here and I've stayed here for 15 years. But do we want to be able to offer experiences on the land for people, and do they go and immerse themselves in that when they can? Yeah. Do they do that on a regular weekly basis? No, they can't. You know, it kind of doesn't make any sense for them. A lot of them, I've had people who started here, and you know, I had one couple where the husband was raised on McDonald's and the wife was raised on, you know, Chef Boyardee, and this is no exaggeration, but like the first year that they joined, they only bought 1 pound of burger, 1 dozen eggs, and 1 pack of butter every single week for an entire year. And I kept thinking, what are they eating? Like, I don't really understand what's going on here. And, because they had a family, like, they had kids and, you know, whatever. But I didn't say anything to them, you know, like, I receive you where you're at, you know. But if I feel like I can, I mean, as I've gotten older, as I've done this a lot longer, then I feel a little bit more liberty to just say, hey, I'm kind of worried about you. Like, you know, are you okay? You know, and I will approach people like that. But, you know, if they're like, I'll respect, you know, their space, if that's what they want. But anyway, yeah, so this couple, I finally said to her, I said, I've been wondering, like, what do you guys eat? You know, like, I don't care that you only come get these 3 things, but I'm just curious, you know? And she says, well, my husband and I, this is our second marriage. And our first marriage is ended because we couldn't conceive. We had trouble conceiving. And when we finally had children, because they both had one child out from their previous marriage, then it destroyed their marriage. Mm. Like the stress of it, the everything. And now they realize these two people, like their spouses, their ex-spouses didn't understand it was a lifestyle. And they recognized it was lifestyle. So then they decided they wanted to test it and figure it out. And so she said, we literally don't know how to cook anything. And so we've just been working to perfect ground beef and eggs. Like that's all we were trying to figure out. And she goes, this year, because it was getting ready to be her second year, she said, this year I'm going to try to buy produce.
100% of the time, for the next, probably the rest of my lifetime, and beyond. it's gonna grow and produce fruit.
As long as someone needs it.
Right.
Infinitely.
Right.
More than you can even eat.
Right.
Abundantly.
We're building abundance.
Right. Okay. But livestock does the same thing.
Right.
The only purpose of livestock is to serve us.
Right.
It's a gift.
It is.
It's a gift from the universe, from God, from whatever everybody wants to call it.
Right.
You know, like, it is a gift.
It is.
And all... And this is a loving universe, but the corporatocracy, the no longer behaving as human institution would like everyone to believe. You said something about you wanted to talk to me about food insecurity. There is no food insecurity. The only insecurity is caused and created by these dehumanized, not operating as human anymore, institutional interference. It is the arrogance of man via institution. So I'm not accusing any direct human being of being some evil, whatever. I'm saying that once a human being creates an institution, it no longer behaves as human. It is no longer responsible as human.
Self-serving at some level, self-serving.
And it's irresponsible. And it's incompetent.
So thinking about some of your community, so you said that people have achieved healthier lives, and they've become, in some cases, even asymptomatic for things that were plaguing. So is there are there people that stay here a while and then the next step in their journey, what do some of those next steps look like for people? I mean, people about to start a homestead, do they share with their neighbors, or kind of what's the next step in their journey after they've achieved some results and some relief?
Well, most people never leave. They don't leave, because even if they are homesteading, which we help them do if they want to, which they can't believe we do that either. And by the way, the Chef Boyardee and McDonald couple, they were taught by us how to raise hogs, how to do chickens, and they were able to decide for themselves that they don't want to do that. They were also happy to know that they had the skills now to do that, and they decided that they really appreciate the ability to support those who only want to do that and love on them by participating here. But they also bought land. They also positioned themselves in a way that they can do that at any moment. But they don't want to only do that.
Okay.
Because they enjoy the camaraderie of being here and the variety that they can receive here. And so they have, you know, their land that is viable with feed, should they put hogs on the land or whatever. But as you know, your garden, your orchard is only going to produce what you're harvesting, or, you know, thereabouts. It will naturally adjust its abundance based on what you harvest. So it's always more than what you need, but it's based on how you harvest. And so they're able to bring some things in if they want, offer it. So we have a kind of a barter system. It's not direct, it's kind of barter, but anyway, depending on what it is that they're bringing and how consistently and how much they want to be responsible for that.
Gotcha.
So we don't do, I don't want to make it seem like, oh, there's a bunch of these side deals going on. That's not true. Everything that we do is clearly outlined. Because if you're operating a business,
right,
then there has to be some structure.
There's a lot of SOPs here, I've noticed, even in the bathroom.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. We have to have some standard operating procedures because we have learned the hard way that, well, I mean, mainly it's because we don't want to disappoint you.
Right.
You know, it's like if we don't have a standard that you can expect whatever, then you could expect everything. And, you know, we just love you too much to make you believe a lie. It's, you know, it just kind of goes back to that. Like, we're not trying to disappoint you. So here's what the rules are. This is what we can, this is our, these are our boundaries of what we know we're capable of consistently providing, and we want to be really good at it. And just like you want to be really good at what you're doing.
Yes.
And, you know, that again has nothing to do with the fact that you are worthy beyond belief. You know, that's the confusion, I think, in society, is that if you do a bad job, then you are unworthy. No, that is not true. You are worthy beyond belief. You're worthy enough that we would want to help train you not to be so incompetent. Incompetence is not unworthiness.
That makes sense. Well, so let me go a slightly different direction.
Okay.
So when you're talking about harvest, do you have members of your community that actually go out and, let's just say harvest, do they go out and participate in a harvest somewhere, or do they garden themselves, or do you pick, or what are those, do you have those members of the community that want to go out and do that?
All of our members do whatever they want. Obviously, like, I don't have any power over them.
Sure.
And I'm not trying to have any power over them.
No.
And it is always my encouragement for everybody to be as radically self-reliant as they can and want to be. Always. The only rules that we have here in terms of purchasing, you know, is, you know, like, we had a dairy co-op for 15 solid years, and actually right now we're looking to reestablish that because our co-op retired. I mean, when we started with them, they were already in their late 60s. So, you know, that's the problem with human beings. You know, we wear out after a little while. And, you know, actually, they lasted a good long time. I mean, consistent every week for 15 years. It's a long time. You know, never missed a week, ever. Never, not one time.
Wow.
So that's solid, right?
Yeah.
Anyway, if you were purchasing dairy, you had to support meat because there's a meat production that goes behind dairy.
Okay.
So we have rules in place like that.
Okay, but like, that's more of a logistics to make.
Well, it's a responsibility that eaters don't understand that, you know, where do you get? Did you know, like, for example, one hog only has about 11 or 12 pounds of bacon on it?
Oh, gotcha, because that's part of the natural succession.
Right. Well, if one hog has 11 or 12 pounds of bacon and 1,000 pounds of sausage behind it,
right,
then you got to eat the other 1,000 pounds of sausage before you can have more bacon.
Yes, we found that out when we started buying our own cows. There's only so many T-bones in that cow.
Right, and if you do T-bones, then you don't have ribeyes, New York strips, or fillets. So that's everything.
We haven't had a T-bone in a long time.
Right. You get over the T-bones real quick, and you're just like, oh, never mind. I would like to do something different with this. Yeah. So, yeah, people have to learn that each animal only has one loin.
Right. That's a big thing. We found that on the community garden, some of those things that people were learning. I guess that's – so I think what I'm – yeah, it sounds like that there's a journey that people are going through. Mm-hmm. And everybody's journey is a little different, it sounds like.
Absolutely. Absolutely. As it should be. And we try to, I mean, it is my hope and desire to be able to nurture that and to, you know, meet everybody where they're at and try to light the path towards being more conscious you know, raising their vibration, pushing them towards the truth and morality, when the corporatocracy had them going in another direction, and they're realizing it themselves, which is the reason why they're interested in being here. You know, whether they say it that way or not, you know, probably not, because there are so many other things going on.
Right.
And I don't think anyone arrives here and expects any of that.
Right.
You know, and then they go, oh, I mean, you just showed up. Did you expect that?
So, yes. but I listened, I've been listening to your videos for a while. I've listened to something where you talk to other people on Michelle Sauce.
Nicole
Sauce.
Yeah.
And I think there was a, if I remember right, you were on a Loose the Goose once.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been listening to those, so I've somewhat onboarded to your philosophy previous to this over a period of time, so I had time to digest it.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, but cool. But this has been wonderful. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
And I've learned a lot, and I've enjoyed it as well. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you. I learned from you too, so.
Awesome.
That's fun, and I always like meeting anybody who's interested in doing stuff, because we can all teach each other something.
We all have different